This morning we're continuing our study of Nehemiah about rebuilding. This is a book about healing. This is a book about restoration. Most importantly, this is a book about the glory of God. And today we're going to continue on the topic that we started to broach just a little bit last week as we looked at the man Nehemiah, this man that God had called to do what looked like an impossible work. And what we found is, as we looked at his life and we saw the type of man that God uses, he uses men that are concerned, he uses men that are broken, he uses men that are prayerful. And when we talk about prayer, you have to understand that literally when you pray, it reveals something about you. I believe that when you listen to a man pray or a woman pray, it honestly says a lot about their walk with Jesus. It says a lot about what they believe. It reveals to them and to us things about God, things about sin, things about grace, things about ourselves. And you see, I want you to understand, church, that prayer for believers, some of you are going to say, well, then I'm suffocating. It's supposed to be as natural as breathing. I want to say that again. Prayers in the life of the believers of Jesus Christ, it's supposed to be as natural as breathing. You say, why is it supposed to be that natural? Why is it supposed to be that easy? Because it doesn't feel that easy. Because our walk with Jesus Christ is a relationship by which he speaks to us. His word speaks to us. It challenges us. It seeks and desires to transform us, to change us. We don't serve a God that sits silent in the heavens. We serve a God that from the beginning of time has been desiring to reveal himself to us. He still speaks today. And prayer is our opportunity to speak back to him. Do you realize what a treasure it is to have prayer? Do you realize what a gift it is when the scripture tells us that we can come confidently into the throne room of grace? No longer divided. There's no longer a veil. There's no longer a separation. Do you realize that Jesus Christ bids us to come? You see, many of us need prayer every single day. This life is scary without God. Can I just say that? This life is impossible without God. And most of us stand around with our knees knocking because we don't have the prayer relationship with Jesus Christ that we need. I want you to know that our knees don't knock when we're kneeling on them. I find it so interesting that we said last week that Nehemiah, this book begins with prayer. This book ends with prayer. And all throughout this book, 10 other times at least, we're going to find that Nehemiah, you know what he's doing? He's praying. Before he works, as he works, after he works, we find this man of God understands the secret to success, and it is getting on our knees and praying to the Lord. I want you to remember that we can meet and conquer our enemies before we ever see them in prayer. Let that sink in a second, what I just said. You can conquer and overcome your enemies before you ever see them if you are a man or woman of prayer. I love Nehemiah because there's so much about his life. There's no inconsistencies between the Old and New Testament scriptures. We see a man, and it's evident today. It's evident last week in this whole chapter, this first chapter of Nehemiah. You know what becomes evident? That Nehemiah will not begin a work until he has counted the cost. He knows what he's facing. He knows what is being asked of him. He knows where this burden that is on his heart is going to take him. And he gets before God. He is counting the cost of what it's going to take to follow God. But he will not stop until he has finished that work. Isn't that who we want to be? And so last week in verse 4, we left off with, "When I heard these words, I sat down. I wept. And I mourned for days. And I was fasting and praying before the God of heaven." And this is the prayer. And folks, I want to tell you, this is a prayer that changes everything. This is the prayer of a believer's heart. This is a prayer that leads us to a point of courage and conviction. Let me read it to you. He begins in verse 5 and he says, in speaking about the prayer he was praying, he said, "I beseech you, O Lord, God of heaven, the great and awesome God who preserves the covenant and loving kindness for those who love him and keep his commandments. Let your ear now be attentive and your eyes open to hear the prayer of your servant, which I am praying before you now, day and night, on behalf of the sons of Israel, your servants, confessing the sons of the sin of Israel, which," underline this, "we have sinned against you. I and my father's house have sinned. We have acted very corruptly against you and have not kept the commandments, nor the statutes, nor the ordinances which you commanded your servant Moses. Remember the word which you commanded your servant Moses, saying, 'If you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the peoples. But if you return to me and keep my commandments and do them, though those of you who have been scattered were in the most remote parts of the heavens, I will gather them from there and I will bring them to the place where I have chosen to cause my name to dwell. They are your servants and your people, whom you redeemed by your great power and by your strong hand. O Lord, I beseech you, may your ear be attentive to the prayer of your servant and to the prayer of your servants who delight to revere your name, and make your servant successful today and grant him compassion before this man. Now I was the cupbearer to the king." My goodness. You want a model for prayer in the Old Testament, my goodness. A prayer that lines up with what Jesus would teach us in the New Testament scriptures about how it is that we should pray. And folks, this morning I want to share with you what this prayer reveals about Nehemiah. And I want you to see what prayer reveals in you and in me this morning. Number one, I want you to see that prayer, when all of us pray, when Nehemiah prayed, you know what it reveals first and foremost? How we see God. What we believe about God. That's what prayer does. I want you to see that in the beginning of this section that we're talking about in verse 5 today, we see that Nehemiah is making sure that he has his heart oriented towards God. Most of us, each and every day, you realize that is the journey, right? We're so tempted to turn away. We're so tempted to go right or left of the Lord. We're so tempted to hear so many other voices. You realize that much of our Christian walk has to do with us taking the time to hear His Word, to know the truth, and then to reorient our life to that truth, to that Word. Folks, if we don't learn day by day, moment by moment, remember we said that this is like breathing for Christians. The reason why, because the second you start to turn, If you're not in the Word, if you're not praying, if that's something that only comes along after great crisis, it's because in the moment that you could have prayed, you could have sought the Lord every moment of every day. How often do we choose so many lesser things? And what began as just a slight turn, we've walked so long without prayer and Bible study. You know what's happened? What could have been such an easy course correction, now we have to journey back. You see, prayer lets us see God. It demands and recognizes that we hear God so that we can go through this life doing the thing that we are supposed to be doing, and that is orienting our hearts to His, our will to His, our thoughts to His, our vision to His. Everything about us becomes about Him. And do you realize how much easier that is when you're praying without ceasing versus you're barely praying at all? You see, he meditates in these verses on the character of God. You see, he has a great task before him. And you see, he has to reorient himself because, listen, there is going to be something inside of all of us when we have this God-sized thing that he's asked us to do. There are things that will try to creep in and turn you away from him. Things like doubt. Things like fear. Other voices that say it's not possible. You're a fool for trying. So many things compete for the voice of God in our life, and we continually have to go back and look at who this God is that we serve. I love the wording that he gives. He just simply begins by saying, "Our Lord, the God of heaven." You know what that says to the people in that day that are listening? There are many gods of the earth around them. They still exist today. Just go around the world. False gods. Gods that can't hear. Gods that can't see. Gods that can't move. If you tip them over, guess what? They can't even pick themselves back up, can they? You throw them in a fire, they're consumed. But you see, the God that we serve isn't a God made by human hands. It's not a God made up in human minds. He is the one true God who is. Amen. And he is not just God over earth. He is Lord of the heavens. You see, the reality is the people needed to remember that God doesn't just rest in Israel. He doesn't just live within the confines and the border of Israel. Well, thank goodness, because his people have been scattered around the world. Lord God of heaven is a declaration that God rules over everything, everywhere. This title became special to Israel in the captivity. You see it more in the books of Ezra and Nehemiah and in the book of Daniel, then you see it almost anywhere else in Scripture. This term for God became extremely important for them in the captivity because it meant that he was with them wherever they were. And listen, wherever they are, and for this matter, listen, wherever you are, don't ever forget that God is ruler. That God is sovereign. That God is in control. You're not so far away that he's lost you. That he's lost control of the circumstances around you. Don't think that you can get so far away from God, he can't act, he can't move, he can't see. It's not about location, it is about his sovereignty, and he is ruler over all. And he says, "I beseech you, God." Why? What does this prayer tell us about how he sees God? He says, "God, you are great." Simply put, it just speaks to the power of God. He needs God to be great. You know why? Because the task is bigger than him. It will take more than he can give by himself. Folks, we have to learn to live in the power of God. How much more in the New Testament when he says, "Believers, don't go and do anything until I send you the Holy Spirit." Why? Because in that moment, power will come upon you. The power to do what? be his witnesses, to take the gospel to the ends of the earth, for God to receive the glory that is due his name. And he will do it through weak vessels who recognize the greatness does not lie in themselves, but lies in the one who lives in them. God is great. And more than that, it says that he is awesome. What a word that almost means nothing today. Why? Because we say lasagna is awesome. Right? That concert last night was awesome. You wish your kids would say, Mom and Dad, you're awesome. They don't, usually say that. And the problem with this word awesome, the problem is if everything is awesome, then almost nothing is awesome anymore. And I wish we would get back to understanding that this word really should be reserved, really for him. Because what the word awesome means, it means that God in his greatness and in his sovereignty and in all that he is, in all of his glory, you know what? We ought to step back. And let me ask, do your prayers reveal, when you go into the presence of God, do you go into his presence with awe, wonder, amazement at the majesty of our God? Because he uses this term awesome, which speaks to the holiness and the majesty of God's character that leaves us in awe. It means to inspire awe. It can also mean terror or dread. Our God is the God of heaven. He's great. He's awesome. But you know, one of the things I love most about God and what his prayer will reveal is that we serve a God that keeps promises. You see, we live in a world where promises are broken every single day. Where between men, even if we call it a covenant, covenants are broken every single day. Do you realize that we serve a God that when he speaks, he means what he says, and he will accomplish what he says? Now, you may say, well, big deal. That's because you don't know the promises of God. If you say big deal to that, it's because you don't know the word of God. You don't know what he has said about you, because if you knew what he said about you, you would agree he's awesome. If you knew how far you were from him, if you knew what it took for you to be saved, and it truly grips your heart, you will be left with nothing but he's awesome. This God who from the beginning has kept his word to us. When you look at these words, he says, this is the God who preserves the covenant. That means that, you know what, if it was up to us, that covenant would be a wreck and a mess, wouldn't it? But when we were unfaithful, let these words sink in. When you are unfaithful, he still is faithful. That's the God we serve. This God keeps his word, and I love that word, hesed, that Old Testament word for what you see there at the end of verse, or the middle of verse 5 there, where it says he preserves the covenant in loving kindness. That is a word that's almost unexplainable in the English language. It is so incredibly difficult to interpret. You know why? Because it's almost like you take all those things about God, grace, mercy, kindness, gentleness, patience, and you boil them all up into one. How do you even describe God in a word? Loving kindness envelops so much of it. He loves us. He is kind towards us. He keeps his promise to us. He shows us great patience. Do you realize that these people, just go back, remember where the people of God are. If there is one thing they need, it is the promise of God and his loving kindness. And here is a man, you know what's revealed in his prayer? He believes in those two things. He knows them to be true, and by faith, he holds them. If you don't have this, then you realize that prayers are going to be powerless on the other end. If you notice, he's not even going to make a request of God until when? The very last sentence of his prayer. Because if you don't believe this, why would you ask him of anything? Do you see how what you believe about him totally impacts what you'll ask of him? See, most of us pray little prayers. Why? Because we, in our mind, we got a little God. He's the last one we go to. He's the Hail Mary. He's, well, I guess this ain't going to work out unless God maybe can somehow save this. If that's your view of God, no wonder you never ask for anything big. Our prayers ought to reveal that we believe he's great and he's awesome. And he's a covenant-keeping God who is full of loving kindness to those who are unfaithful. He invites us back. Secondly, prayer reveals how we see sin. Because I'm going to tell you this, when you really see God rightly, you know what becomes apparent? He is so holy. He is so righteous. We know, listen, you may think that there's going to be a day when you'll stand in the face of God and tell him what's up. Get over that. Because in that day, you know what you're going to do? You're going to do what every other knee does. You're going to bow. And you're going to confess that he's Lord. When we talk about the awesomeness of God, so much of that is bound up in the fact that he's never sinned, ever. He always does what is right, good, and holy. When we stand before a person like that, when we stand before a God who we know that is true, it automatically shines a light. Remember, God is light, isn't he? Isn't that what it says? Why did people reject Jesus? Because he came and he shined light into the dark places of their life. And what did they want? They wanted to hide. You see, that's why I believe also so many of us forsake prayer. It's why I believe so many of us forsake Bible study. It's because when we draw close to God, the light just gets what? Just gets brighter. Folks, I want to tell you again, that is the process of growing as a believer. There will never be a moment, I don't care how old you live to be, that God isn't shining light into the dark spaces of your life. And I praise God that he doesn't come to us, that we have this beautiful part of our salvation we call sanctification, where he allows us to mature in our faith. And I'm going to tell you this, he's going to deal with your sin, and in the moment that he deals with one sin, you know what's there? He shines that light on another one. And he shines that light on another one. And he shines that light on another one, not because he's being difficult, but because he wants you to be free. And he allows you to mature and to grow. And that's part of why we come into his presence, is because we want his light to shine into the darkness of our lives that is leading us towards death and destruction. And we want him to rebuild. We want him to restore. Verse 6 and 7, we see in his prayer how it reveals how he sees sin. It's so interesting. He says, Lord, let your ear now be attentive. There are most of us that think that if we're in sin, his ear is what? Turned away and deaf towards us. But listen, he goes before him and he says, Lord, let your ear be attentive. Why? Because he's about to come before the Lord and he's about to confess sin. He's about to agree with God about the condition of the children of Israel and how they got where they were. That it's not someone else's fault. It's not God's fault. But here is a man that's going to say, ultimately, you know what he's going to say? It's my fault. Now, you could argue, and there's a part of us that wants to argue for Nehemiah, because we want to say, no, Lord, listen, that happened before he was born. The things that you are discussing, the things that he is saying that he is sorry for, you almost want to say the children of Israel, they're in exile because of his fathers, because of his grandfathers. It has nothing to do with Nehemiah. But folks, we misunderstand sin when we think we can boil it down to just us and how it affects us. there's something that happens when we are children of God. You know what it says? Just like in marriage, we become what? There's a oneness that cannot be separated. There's a oneness with Him. There's a oneness with the body of Christ. He says, let your ear be attentive. Please let your eyes be open to the prayer of your servant, which I am praying before you now, day and night, on behalf of the sons of Israel, your servants. He says, I mean, and the thought of what it's saying here. Here is a man that is so, we talked about it last week, burdened over the sins of his people, including himself. You know what he's doing? He's praying day and night, praying day and night, praying day and night. We might ask, well, what kind of ministry is he doing? No, he is doing the most important ministry. He's praying. See, we get it backward. We think prayer is the thing we do when nothing else we do works. No, prayer is where it all begins. Prayer is where it all happens. Prayer is where victory is found. He's not spending day and night doing other things. He's spending day and night seeking the face of God. And he says, I'm praying not just for myself. He's praying for the sons of Israel and what has happened to God's people. And he's says he's confessing the sins of the sons of Israel, which, who? What does it say? Look at the, I was going to say the bottom of the page. It's probably not the bottom of the page in your Bible. Turn to page 697. No, I'm kidding. It says, confessing the sins in verse 6 of the sons of Israel, which who? Which we have sinned against you. Isn't it interesting? A lot of us, when we want to start talking about prayer and we start praying about sin, a lot of times we're praying for somebody else, aren't we? They. In marriage, we probably spend more time praying about the other person than we do ourselves. Lord, change them. What if he's up there going, how about I change you? How about we start with you? Let your prayer life reveal the fact that you recognize there is a work that God's got to do in you. He leaves they out and he picks up we. We sinned against you. I. That's about as personal as it gets. I and my father's house, we have sinned. It's not just them. I like what G.K. Chesterton said. One of our great pastors from the past, he once wrote perhaps what was probably the shortest essay ever in history. The London Times, they sent out a call for writers. And this man loved to write, and they wanted essays on the following topic. What's wrong with the world? Chesterton replied, "Dear sirs, I am sincerely yours." G.K. Chesterton. Do you realize that it truly is that simple? What's wrong with the world? If I ask you that question, you would go off and you'd say it's the Republicans. You'd say it's the Democrats. You'd say it's the president. You'd say it's Congress. You'd say it's anything. It's my mother-in-law. You'd say it's my children. You'd say, I mean, you would come up with anything and everything. And most times, the last thing we would even think to say is, me. Wow, what does this prayer reveal about his heart? Folks, let me remind you that it is a gift, truly a gift, to be able to confess your sin before God. You know why? Because there is no sin that God can't forgive, so there should be no sin that you don't confess. In fact, I would go on and say probably one of the greatest hindrances to this process in our spiritual life is the fact that we're just simply, in many ways, not specific enough. Don't pray confession prayers like, Lord, if I have sinned, just go home and ask your wife. She'll say, oh, yeah. Ask your kids. They'll say, oh, yeah. It's not a matter of getting before God and say, if I have sinned. you need to get before the Lord and think about, walk with him, talk to him. He wants you to come out of the bushes and into a relationship by which he wants to help you course correct. You know how that's going to happen? You know how you're going to orient your life towards the things of God and the purposes of God and walk with him is moment by moment, day by day. Confession isn't something you do just when you get saved, but every moment as he shines light, you confess and you let him work. Is that what your prayer life is like? Most of us, it's just about the meal. Most of it's just about, now I lay me down to sleep. I'm talking about prayer on a whole different level than most of us do it. Because, folks, this is the world that we live in, a world where no one wants to accept responsibility for their sin. You can't make spiritual progress in your life until you learn to deal with the sin that is in your life. On a day-by-day, moment-by-moment basis. Did Jesus pay it all? Yes. If you're in Christ, will you stand before him forgiven, justified because of what happened the moment you were saved? Yes. But don't leave out this process he calls sanctification. He didn't die so you could stay the same scoundrel you were. He died so that you could be free and bring glory to him in your life. As one commentator put it, he said, we don't study theology to make our head fat. We study theology to make our heart right. It's about change. It's about repentance. Number three, prayer reveals how we see grace. It reveals how we see God, how we see sin. It also reveals how we see grace. You see, I told you in the beginning, we serve a God who keeps his promises. That's what 8 and 9 is all about. Remember the word which you commanded your servant Moses, saying, if you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the peoples. Folks, that's a promise. Now, that's not a promise like we think of a promise. We want the promise to be, you're going to go to heaven one day. We want the promise to be, I'm going to make you rich. We want the promise to be, I'm going to make you successful. We like those positive promises. But God makes promises on both ends of the spectrum. Just as surely as he talks about blessing, do you realize that he also talks about cursing? Do you realize that in this covenant that God has given to us, look at the nature of what he said. Remember the word which you were commanded, or you commanded your servant Moses, saying, if you are unfaithful, I will what? I will scatter you. Now, he's talking to a people who are scattered. He is simply reminding them that God keeps what? His promise on both ends. Heaven is as much a promise as hell, or should I say hell is as much a promise as is heaven. It's hard to think of it like that, isn't it? Unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except what? By me. Do you realize that that promise is a two-edged sword? It promises life to those who believe. It promises death to those who don't. And you see, here's the beauty. You say, well, where's grace in that? That little three-letter word that begins verse 9. But you were dead in your trespasses and sin. But aren't you glad for that little word? But God has made you alive in Christ. Yes, God said that if you don't follow my commandments, I will scatter you among the nations. But he goes on in verse 9 and says, but if you return to me, and if you'll keep my commandments and do them, though those of you who have been scattered to the most remote parts of the heavens, you know what that's saying? Let me put it in today's vernacular. No matter how far you think you've gone, you can always what? You can always come home. Do you see the beauty of that? Do you see the hope in that? Do you see the grace that is in that? It literally is what Kevin prayed about earlier, the prodigal son who went and dishonored his father in a way that no one could have ever imagined you could ever come back from. Yet when he finally realized, I am better off a doorman in my father's house, a slave in my father's house, than to be out here among all this pig slop. He got up and he went home fully expecting to be made a servant. Yet where was the father? He was waiting and watching for the son to return. And he didn't make him a servant. You know what he did? He reminded him, you're a son. That's grace. That's grace. Though you have been scattered, though you are so far from me, think about how far the heavens extend. You can always come back. You're never too far. Though you've been scattered in the most remote part of the heavens, I will gather them from there, and I will bring them to the place that I have chosen to cause my name to dwell. And of course, he was talking about Jerusalem. Nehemiah knew that God's grace would bring them back. Every prophet spoke, though there was so much judgment in the prophets, there was always in every prophet chapters on hope, on a remnant, on the return. And he clung to it and he believed it because he knew that he served a God of grace and mercy and restoration. Here's the good news. When we're honest before God in brokenness and repentance, that's when we experience his mercy and restoration. It's actually a gift to know and to own your own sin. Let me say that again. It is actually a gift to know and to own your own sin. Don't minimize it. Don't try to rename it. Don't try to manage it. Kill it by confessing it and repenting of it. Fourthly, prayer reveals how we see ourselves. Don't ever forget who you are as a child of God. Don't ever forget whose you are. I love the way that he words it here. Really, it doesn't even take explanation. Nehemiah stands there and he says, they are your servants. They are your people. You ready? They are redeemed. How often in life do you forget that very important fact? I'm redeemed. I've been bought back with the price of Christ's blood. The sacrifice has been made. I have been restored. I am justified. I am being sanctified. There is a day coming that I will be glorified. Have you forgotten that, church? Have you forgotten who you are? That's what makes you run back to the bushes. He can't love me, and you forget, for God so loved the world. He can't forgive me, and you forget that he said. He demonstrated his love towards you in that while you were yet and still a sinner, that's actually when he died for you. When you were at your worst, not your best. Isn't it awesome to remember you're redeemed and that you're his? And you know what it goes on and says? It was his great power and it was his strong hand that saved us. It's our only hope in this world. God's great power, His strong hand. He and He alone is the only one who's mighty to save. Folks, when you see God clearly, when you see your sin clearly, when you see grace clearly, when you see who you are in Christ clearly, you know what it's going to give you? Confidence. That's why so many of us never attempt great things for God. We don't have the confidence. And you know why you don't have the confidence? Because of the things we just talked about. Because when you get those things, now you're ready to step into the arena, and now you're ready to fight. Now you're ready to grab a hold of what God has grabbed hold of you for to accomplish His purposes. Now you're ready to do impossible things. Now you're ready to do things greater than yourself. Because you finally come to the realization it's His great power, and it's His strong hand, and it's His grace. And the only reason you stand ready to be used by God as a trophy of grace is because of what He's done for you. And now, all that praying has led up to confidence in verse 11. Folks, build your prayer life upon the promises of God so that you can come to God with gospel confidence, with right heart and right motives. I want you to notice that all of these things that have been talked about, all these attributes of God, all of this recognition of sin and self, and remembering who we are in Christ, all of this are related to the very thing that He wants to ask. It's related to the objective. It inspires confidence for the mission that God has. O Lord, I beseech You, and may Your ear be attentive to the prayer of Your servant and the prayer of Your servants who delight and revere Your name. Make Your servant successful today. All the way at the end of this prayer finally comes a request. Make Your servant successful today and grant him compassion before this man. This man is Artaxerxes. This man is the one who can tell Nehemiah, you're not going back to Israel. You're not going to be able to go build a wall. Literally everything that happens is because God turns the heart of this king. Proverbs 21 says something very interesting. It says, the king's heart is a stream of water in the hand of the Lord. He turns it wherever He wills. Let me read that again. The king's heart is a stream of water in the hand of the Lord. He turns it wherever He will. Does Nehemiah have any capacity to change the heart of a man? No, only God does. That's why he's praying. That's why he's asking. The same thing that happened to him was God changed his heart. And if God can change this stubborn heart, you know what I believe? He can change any stubborn heart. And now he has the confidence to ask. It's amazing because you know what the problem is with King Artaxerxes? He ain't a believer. He could care less about the walls of Jerusalem. It's not his people. It's not his problem. If you were on the outside looking in, you would have to say, he hasn't got a chance. Why would Artaxerxes care? Well, he's going to care because a man prayed and God changed his heart. Do you realize what Nehemiah is praying for? Change the heart of this king, this unbelieving king. Why? Because Nehemiah believes it's the only way the king will listen to him. God has to change his heart. Folks, I want you to ask big things of God because you have great affliction in your life. You have great trial in your life. You have great obstacles in your life. You have great enemies. Great distress. There might be a great work that lies ahead of you that's bigger than yourself that God has asked you to do. My question is, do you believe that He's big enough to conquer the things that you face? Nehemiah believes. As Kevin comes this morning, I just want to conclude with what we can learn, some things we can see this morning. And I want to just say that the last thing that I really said is one of the most important things that I said this morning. Never forget that God can change people's hearts. See, most of us in this room, that's one of the greatest needs we have in our life, is we need God to do a work in us, but we also need Him to do a work possibly in the person next to us, in the lives of our children. There's definitely, listen, nobody comes to the table and it's all one person's fault, one person's problem, is it? It takes God really working and changing in the heart of two lives to make restoration happen, to make so much of what He's doing happen. It is possible for God to move men, but it's by prayer alone. Some of you need to remember again that God can change the heart of a rebellious son, a prodigal daughter, an unbelieving spouse. Folks, I want you to remember today that we can pray big things. Why? Because we serve a God who is awesome and great. Strong hand. Powerful. The kind of requests that you make say something about what you think about God. What do your prayers say about God's power? A challenging question I read this week, and it simply said, if someone's estimation of God were based entirely on your prayers, how great would they think God is? In light of all that's happening in the world today, don't you think it's time the church started praying? Don't you think it's time that the church pray for big things? Father, we thank You this morning for prayer, that we can just come in and we can sit in Your presence and we can hear Your voice. You speak through Your word. You challenge us. You call us. You send us. Lord, give us the courage to come into Your presence and to respond to what You're saying. Let Your light shine in. Father, today may we get back to the place that we really see You as awesome. And we know what that means. Great. That You're Lord of heaven. God, may we be changed because of these words of this prayer today. Lord, we find You so willing to forgive if we'll just confess and repent. Though we're scattered, You'll bring us home. Though You've kept Your promise to discipline and to judge, Lord, You tell us, but I'm willing to forgive if You will follow. God, there may be someone here today that for the first time they want to follow Jesus. Lord, I pray that today they would understand it's because of the cross. It's because of what happened on Calvary that we are forgiven. You died to take our place. You were buried. You rose again victorious over sin. And You can give life to those who will cry out to You for forgiveness and freedom. Lord, that key is freedom. You ask us to repent, to turn, to follow You with our whole heart, to surrender our lives to You. Father, if there's someone here that finds life, give them courage today to pray right where they are. If You're pricking their heart, Lord, and we pray for their hearts, that You would change their hearts this morning. Call them, convict them, save them today. Give them the courage to come up in this invitation and declare what You've done. And Father, for Your church, God, may You stir us to pray. And may it reveal what we truly believe. In Jesus' name, amen.